I invite you to open your Bibles, if you have them, to Matthew chapter 6. I'll read from verses 9 to 13. Pray then like this. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come. Your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we also have forgiven our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. As a kid growing up in Philadelphia, I had kind of an evening ritual going to bed and seeing the poster on my wall with the Lord's Prayer on it. And sometimes praying it, usually like this. I do my thing. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth. Amen. And then I would just wait for blessing. You know, I'd done my duty, my incantation to the divine. And now he owed me. Definitely going to win my ice hockey game tomorrow. Just waiting for that college acceptance letter. The divine had been put on notice. The Lord's Prayer is perhaps the most beautiful prayer in the world, and perhaps it is the most abused prayer in the world. And it's often just rambled through instead of understood and embraced and truly prayed and truly lived. And as we ramble through the prayer, we miss out on the opportunity to understand not just prayer, but the Lord's teaching on the purpose of life. So let me ask you an important question. What's the purpose of life? What's the purpose of your life? What makes your life worth living? Now, one way that we can look at this question of what the purpose of life is and should be for the Christian is to see what Jesus taught us in how to pray. Jesus' foundational prayer reflects the foundational, essential Christian life. Let me say this again. In Jesus' foundational model prayer, we can find tremendous insight, perhaps even call it a summary of Jesus' teaching on the foundational, essential Christian life and purpose. Now, there's a basic biblical principle that we can see a little later in this chapter in verse 21. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. And similarly, what you pray about and for, there your heart is also. Your prayers are a reflection of your heart. So if we want to understand the Lord's heart, the Lord's treasure, we can find it in the Lord's Prayer. Now, it's commonly understood that there are two parts to the Lord's Prayer, the first half being the first three petitions and the second half being the second three petitions. I agree with the structure. But I want to make a suggestion that the two parts relate to each other, and I want to make a suggestion as to how the two parts relate to each other, and we'll talk more about that later. So let's dig into the text. Our Father. Now, first of all, this is a shockingly direct and personal addressing of God in prayer as Father. And then secondly, Jesus shockingly incorporates us into his sonship. Now, if there was anyone who could claim exclusive right to address God as my Father exclusively, it was Jesus Christ. So in teaching us to pray to God as our Father, Jesus invites us into corporate familial identity. Every single time we address God as our Father, I think we should be reminded of our merciful adoption in Christ. We were all orphans. Imagine what prayer sounds like to God. every single moment of every single day in thousands of languages, in hundreds and hundreds of millions of voices, beautiful voices of young and old spiritual adoptees calling out to God saying, "My Father, our Father." And one day, our Father will be addressed as "My Father" by children of God from every tribe and language and people and nation on earth. In heaven, here we see that there is an overwhelming, undeniable otherness of God. God in heaven, that God has perspective, heavenly perspective that we do not share. He has unbelievable reach. He has grand exaltation. He has heavenly authority. And to this God in heaven, we, the church, the global church, are taught to pray. And we can see in the first three petitions, this first half, prayers for worship, kingdom, and obedience. First, worship. Hallowed be your name. So here, purpose is now revealed. The first petition that Jesus teaches us to pray is toward the glory and worship of our Heavenly Father. Hallowed be your name. It's a New Testament flip side of the third commandment. May your name not be taken in vain, but instead may it be treated as holy. It is a heartfelt prayer that God would be worshiped and adored. It is a prayer that nothing would compete with our affection for God. We are to pray for a holy and stark and evident, undeniable contrast in our lives between the hallowing of God in our lives and the worship, adoration, or affection toward anyone or anything else. I think if I could say just one word, one just perfectly appropriate and fitting and glorious word of worship to my Lord for eternity, one single word to capture this worship petition, I think it might be the word worthy. Though the Sanhedrin declared of Christ, "He is worthy of death." Each follower of Christ will one day join 10,000 times 10,000 angels in the loud and eternal song of praise. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain to receive power and wealth and wisdom and strength and honor and glory and praise. So each one of us are to pray and to live out, "Hallowed be your name." But personal doxology is not enough. God's purposes are global, and God's people should have a holy dissatisfaction with the worshiplessness of the world. That more than 2.99 billion people in the world have little or no access to the gospel of Jesus Christ. And those 2.99 billion do not worship or hallow the blessed and the worthy name of God who created them. Hallowed be your name, not just personal, but global. And not just doxological, but also petitional. This is not just a doxological statement, a praise statement. Hallowed be your name. It is a petition. It is a cry to God to mobilize, to work in power, to bring about the worship of his name. And we'll come back to this in a little bit. Your kingdom come. This is very much related to the first petition. As each individual hallows and worships God, the kingdom grows. As each family hallows and worships God, the kingdom grows. As each nation hallows and worships God, the kingdom grows. Your kingdom come. Do it, Lord. We can't. Help us. That is our cry. Jesus teaches us to pray kingdom ushering, kingdom calling prayers. So, how far have we come toward the building of the kingdom of God. We have seen tremendous, tremendous advances toward the global expansion of the kingdom of God. Christianity today is a more global faith than at any time in history. There are Christians literally in every single nation on earth. There has been tremendous kingdom growth, especially in Latin America and Africa and Asia. Christianity is today stronger in the southern hemisphere than in the north, and stronger in the east than in the west. And that growth is a part of a very important message, that Christianity is not an American religion and missions is not west to east. It is from everywhere to everywhere, reflecting both the reality of the global church and also the global goal of our faith. In the Lord's Prayer, in the whole of the Bible, we see that God's purpose for his people, the purpose for every single Christian from every single nation, is to pray toward and pursue his global glory through the global spread and enjoyment of the gospel. From every nation to every nation a mission-sending nation, every nation a part of God's global and eternal purposes, every church, every Christian, a part of God's global and eternal purpose. Today, nearly 70% of the world's mission force is from the non-Western world. The gospel is going forth from everywhere to everywhere. Christians throughout the world are reaching the lost in their own nations, which is evangelism, and reaching the unreached in others, which is missions. In South America, there's been phenomenal growth of the church and passion for global missions. Brazilians are reaching their own, many of whom have not traditionally been the object of the church's love. I have a friend in Brazil who has an outreach to transvestites in his city. And they've seen the power of the gospel transform the lives of former transvestites who discover their true identity in Jesus Christ. Brazilian churches are also reaching the nation, sending out more than 2,000 missionaries to reach the unreached. It was actually Brazilian churches that were the first that I had heard of that were investing 75% of their church budgets for global missions. God is doing amazing things in and through Asians, reaching their own and reaching the world. 100 years ago, in Korea, there were less than 20,000 Christians. Today, South Korea has sent out more than 21,000 missionaries to 175 nations of the world. So the South Korean church is close to sending out more missionaries today than the American church. 8 out of the 10 largest churches in the world are in South Korea. In fact, 8 out of the 10 largest churches in the world are in the city of Seoul. How about China? Even though the 200 Chinese pastors and leaders who were invited to attend the 3rd Lausanne Congress in Cape Town were prevented by the Chinese police from getting on their airplanes to South Africa, the Lord used that whole experience to identify and unite the top leaders of the Chinese house church. And it's been a tremendous joy and privilege for us as a movement and for me personally to help to facilitate strategic planning of an historic national effort by the Chinese church for global mission. That includes, number one, did you know that in China there are 100 cities with a population of 1 million or more? 100 cities. In those 100 cities, there are 5,000 train and subway stops. The goal now is by the year 2030 to plant a church at every single one of those 5,000 subway and train stops. Another goal is to send out missionaries from China. In the 200-year history of modern global missions sending into China, there have been 20,000 missionaries that have been received into China. The goal now by the Chinese house church is to send out from China 20,000 missionaries especially to the unreached peoples of the world. Repaying the debt, the missionary debt, to the global church. If the Lord blesses these humanly impossible goals, it will impact the whole world. I got an email from a friend of mine in Nigeria, Daniel Atieye. I had asked him about his safety, as I knew that because of his outreach to Muslims, he receives death threats 2-3 times a week. And he writes to me, "Michael, as a matter of fact, last night I was told to come out of my house and that the Muslims will come to attack me in the house where I live. But I stayed and prayed. And this is now morning, and I am alive. Praise the Lord." I don't think Daniel needs coffee to perk him up in the morning. "I'm alive. Praise the Lord" will suffice. Try that tomorrow morning. In 10 years, they've shared the gospel of Jesus Christ more than 40,000 times. During those 10 years, more than 5,000 Islamic scholars have turned to Christ. The global church is reaching out and mobilizing from every nation to every nation. But there is much work to be done toward the building of God's kingdom. According to the Joshua Project, there are still more than 6,600 unreached people groups in the world that represent more than 2.99 billion people. 41% of all people groups remain unreached. The unreached people group concept and strategy was introduced at the first Lausanne Congress in 1974. I wasn't there personally, but it was and still is today at the very heart of the Lausanne movement, reaching every unreached people group with the gospel of Jesus Christ. And so we work toward and we pray, "Lord, may your kingdom come among the 6,600 unreached people groups in the world. Lord, mobilize your church toward that end." And for the building of God's kingdom, for the hallowing of God's name, we pray, "Your will be done." It is a prayer for God's revealed will to be done. And the essential way that God's will is done is and honored is when God's people obey. When we live out the purposes of God in our lives, when we live for God in every aspect of our lives with love for God, with all of our heart and soul and mind and strength. Worship, kingdom, obedience. So from the first three petitions, let me suggest a summary of Jesus' purpose of life for every Christian from every nation. To passionately pray for and pursue the global and eternal worship of and living for God. To passionately pray for and pursue the global and eternal worship of and living for God. This starts on the individual level and also includes family, corporately in the church, and culminates globally. As Christ's purpose for life is lived out by every Christian in every land, the gospel will flow naturally, powerfully, passionately from every land to every land. Hallowed be your name, your kingdom come, your will be done. What is this but the passionate prayer and pursuit of global and eternal worship of and living for God? Now let's move on to the second part of the Lord's Prayer, which has been described by some commentators as focusing on personal needs. But as I alluded to before, I believe that these two sections in the Lord's Prayer are much more than just two sections with two different themes, but that the two sections are very much related to each other. Commentators, good commentators, suggest that the first three petitions focus on the preeminence of God, while the final three focus on personal needs. But there's more than just that. In the first half, Jesus teaches us to cry out to God to accomplish, even through our prayers and lives, God's purpose for global and eternal worship. And the second part is not just now a prayer for personal needs, but instead it is a prayer for provision of all that is needed for such purpose of life laid out in the first section. Let me say this again. The second half of the Lord's Prayer is prayer for provision of all that is needed for the purpose of life, which is to passionately pray for and pursue the global and eternal worship of and living for God. The second half of the prayer is intimately related to the first half. It's not just that the first half is a big picture and the second is a little picture, or that the first half is a spiritual side and the second is the earthly, or that the first is the corporate and the second is individual. No. The second half is prayer for the provision of all that is needed for the purposes expressed in the first half. It starts off like this. Give us this day our daily bread. A prayer for our basic needs. Towards the life that passionately prays for and pursues the global and eternal worship of and living for God, we have needs. Bread. The standard is not luxury, but sustenance. We live in a country where we have to deliberately limit our food intake and the caloric content of our food. Has the prayer, "Give us this day our daily bread," become meaningless in our society and our churches? And if not, then what could God be trying to teach you? Would you pray and ask the Lord about this? Ask him, "Lord, why should I even pray this prayer? I don't need to. I have two cars. I have a retirement fund. I have disposable income." Why would the Lord have you pray, "Give us this day our daily bread"? You know, only America could have invented such a term, disposable income. Essentially, disposable income is saying that everything beyond daily bread, everything beyond sustenance is mine. Everything beyond daily bread is discretionary funds. Perhaps then the reason why Jesus teaches us to pray, "Give us this day our daily bread," is because he wants us to view every gift, every dollar, every resource, not as a personal slush fund, but as provision to pursue passionately Christ's purpose for life, for the global and eternal worship of and living for God. And that our passionate living toward and generous giving toward such global purpose might even foolishly require us to tangibly need God's help for our daily bread. Next, "Forgive us our debts as we have forgiven our debtors." What is this? This is a prayer for forgiveness and the power to forgive others. This is a reminder now of our most basic spiritual need. Our basic physical need, our most basic spiritual need, forgiveness. It's a reminder of our sinfulness and also a reminder of God's mercy. It's a reminder of the gospel, the very foundation of the purpose of God emphasized in the first half of the Lord's Prayer. The gospel is to be received and also extended to others. 100 years ago, the gospel began to take root in Korea. The gospel reached my own family through Presbyterian missionaries. I'm the fifth generation of believer on my father's side. It was that faith that helped them to endure one of the darkest periods of Korean history during the Japanese occupation from 1910 to 1945. As many as 30 million Asians lost their lives at the hands of the Japanese Imperial Army. Perhaps the greatest loss of human life in the history of mankind. My own great aunt was married off as a young teenager to avoid becoming one of the more than 150,000 young Korean women and girls as young as 12 years old who were forced to be sex slaves of the Japanese army. and endured horrific treatment dozens of times per day. In the strange and beautiful providence of God, he saw fit to eventually send my father to America, only to have him later say goodbye to his son, heading back to Asia to bring the gospel to the land of his former enemy. From every land to every land, even from Korea to Japan, glorious gospel design. Lead us not into temptation. Temptation, this seems key. Between our individual salvation and the pursuit of global eternal worship of God lies temptation. What is this? Perhaps for some, that temptation is the worshiping of, the hallowing of, God's very provision. Daily bread hoarded, like the Israelites hoarding manna in the wilderness. Perhaps the temptation includes the idolizing of God's spiritual blessings as well, the idolizing of grace and spiritual comfort. And this idolatry of Christian comfort is something that I can understand. It's the comfort of God's grace and love, the comfort of my own salvation, the comfort of a marvelous guaranteed future. But rather than looking at our own blessed circumstances and then the unfortunate circumstances of others who are without Christ and saying, thank God I'm not them, we need to recognize that our circumstances are by the grace of God alone and pray for mercy that we avoid the temptations of our blessed circumstances. Have you ever considered for a moment the absolute mercy and blessedness that you were born into your circumstances? You could just as easily have been born in the slums of Mumbai or in Nagoya, Japan, as a son of a Shinto priest. Mercy and grace. And if you had been born in the slums of Mumbai or as a son of a Shinto priest, how would you want the people in this room to respond? The temptation of our spiritual hermitage. So easy for Christians to pray for and live for these verses in the second half. So easy for us to skip the first section that lays out the very purposes of God for our lives, God's purposes in his world. Too many Christians have made the second half, the provision of God, their purpose. Those provisions are prayed for and provided to serve his purposes for this world, for global and eternal worship of and living for God. God provides those resources not as a purpose of life, but toward the pursuit of his glorious will. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. There is severe and deadly persecution of the church in many nations around the world, especially in the 1040 window. The most severely persecuted church in the world is in North Korea. In North Korea, you have all of the greatest human challenges of the world combined. Severe poverty, oppressive communism, global isolation, no political freedom, no religious freedom, no gospel. Around North Korea, you can see some signs with these words. We have nothing to envy. Now, of course, this is ridiculous in a nation with so little food and no freedom or hope. But it wasn't always so. In the early 1900s, the capital city of Pyongyang was known as the Jerusalem of the East. In 1907, the year of the great Pyongyang revival, 50,000 Koreans came to Christ. But since 1995, close to 5 million North Koreans have died of starvation. According to one source, more than 500,000 have fled to China for survival, mostly women, and 80% of them have been raped and sexually trafficked. As many as 1 million have been killed in concentration camps with cruel brutality. Nowhere in the world is persecution of Christians so fierce. Despite the risks, the church is growing. There are an estimated 400,000 believers. North Korean Christians who have nothing of worldly value understand that in Jesus Christ, they have nothing to envy. But we Christians in America, we who have everything, so much food and so much freedom, so many resources, we who have the gospel, we envy. We envy as we see the people around us, as we watch TV, as we envy their house, their car, their position, their education, their looks, their family, their girlfriend, their boyfriend, their spouse. Christian, you have nothing to envy. We have everything. We have Jesus Christ. Can we not learn that important lesson that the North Korean government would teach us? We have nothing to envy. So where do we go from here? What can you do for global missions? Let me just suggest a few things. Number one, respond to the gospel. One of my favorite pastors, who's now with the Lord, Jim Boyce of 10th Church in Philadelphia, he used to teach about financial giving, and he used to say this. He said, think about the gospel and then give in response to the gospel. I think it's the same principle for the whole of our lives. Think of the gospel and then live your life in response to the gospel. Friends, look at your lives. Look at your life honestly. You know, what does your life say about your purpose or goal? In how you use your time and how you spend money and what drives you and your passions and what you pray about and how you view the world. Let your life be a gospel-centered, gospel-focused, gospel-empowered, gospel-responding, gospel-advocating life. Number two, repent. Repent. Repentance is not just for the moment you believe in Jesus Christ and become a Christian. Repentance should be core to who we are. Daily, moment by moment, repentance. May we not just talk casually about, yeah, I know in this and that way my life is out of line with the purposes of God. May we not take any sin lightly. Our response to sin should not be resigned or, oh well, but, oh God, have mercy on me. Turn me from sin. Change me. Turn me toward yourself and your purposes. Thirdly, pray. Pray the Lord's Prayer. Really. Pray the prayers of Scripture back to God. He delights in that. Pray God's purposes back to Him. Make God's agenda your agenda. Make God's passions your passions. Pray for the world. God, may your name be hallowed in Japan. Your kingdom come in North Africa. Your will be done in China. This is a ministry. Do not underestimate the power of a prayer ministry for global missions. Jesus is teaching us and empowering us for prayer ministry for the world in the Lord's Prayer. And four, finally, live it out. Live it out. Live out the passions and the purposes of God. How? Invest in God's purposes with the whole of your life. Now, it kind of starts with a basic question of how are we to enjoy life properly? It's such a basic principle that is so simple, but it's also so easy to forget, okay? Every gift of God is to be enjoyed as from God and not like a God. That everything that is enjoyed, be enjoyed theistically, Christocentrically. That every single blessing be recognized as a blessing from God and every resource mobilized toward His purposes. For example, music. I have a wonderful friend, David Kim, who is the concertmaster of the Philadelphia Orchestra. He's an amazing musician and also a wonderful Christian brother. Now, music can be enjoyed atheistically or secularly or without any reference at all to God. It can be received and enjoyed really idolatrously, worshipped in a sense like a god. Or it can be employed doxologically to the glory of God, received and employed as a gift from God for his glory, not worshipped like a god stealing glory from the one true God. David gave an amazing performance during a benefit concert that he did for our ministry in Japan back in 2003. And at the end of his encore, he had tears in his eyes, which brought tears to his wife's eyes as well, as she said to me that she had never seen David cry before at a concert. I think that in some sense, David found eternal purpose for his music at that benefit concert. What it means to enjoy and employ music doxologically, both for his own personal doxology of God and also for the cause of global doxology. And the same can be said, I think, for law or business, sports, sales, whatever. I've seen God powerfully use music and missions, architecture, sports, outreach, technology, medicine. You all have gifts that God has given to you that can be mobilized for global impact in missions. For example, raise your hand if you speak English. So a lot of you. God can use that. English teaching is the most common mission work in Japan. So what I'm advocating is this. The stewardship of life with all things received from God, serving God's purposes and passions. Every gift and talent enjoyed and employed for God and his purposes. And the easiest, clearest, most impacting, and at the same time the hardest way is with money. In good times and bad, Jesus' teaching remains the same. Where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. So money is the best indicator of your heart passions and priorities, and thus the best place to start oftentimes. If you make $25,000 per year, you are the richest 10% of the world. You didn't know it, but you are the uber rich. Congratulations. You can walk out of this room with your head high. In fact, if you make $2,500 per year, you are the richest 15% of the world. And if you make $50,000 per year, you are the richest 1% of the world. I was speaking at a conference, and one of the seminars being given was on how to become a billionaire. Unfortunately, I was also teaching a seminar at the same time, so I couldn't go. So I'm sorry, I have no good tips for you. But I do want to talk about how to become a millionaire. On the internet, they have a bunch of sites with these millionaire calculators. And you can like figure out how long it's going to take until you become a millionaire, depending on how much money you have, how much you save, and assuming some percentage return on your savings, like 6 or 8%. So if you have no money at all right now, because you spent all your money at the bookstore, but you're determined to become a millionaire, let me help you out, because this is important. You'll want to save $5,000 per year, and at 8% interest, you'll become a millionaire in 36 years and 10 months. The point is that the target is in sight. It's doable. So drop me an email or whatever it is that they use at that time and let me know that you made it. Let's pray. Or, we're not done yet. Let's say you invest $5,000 per year in global kingdom building. In 36 years and 10 months, you will have been able to invest the equivalent of about $1 million in Jesus' name hallowing, kingdom building, eternity altering global mission work. The point is that the target is in sight. It's doable. I guarantee you also that in heaven, the return on all the funds invested in God's kingdom will yield you much, much more than 8%. What wonderful discipleship to be able to tell your kids and your grandkids one day that you invested $1 million in global missions. The world would be transformed if God would give you the grace and the guts to do this. I know you won't regret it. I would just encourage you to start. Decide in your own heart how God would have you start. Let me also say that transparency in finances with your children allows for an amazing opportunity for their discipleship. It's very clear from Jesus' emphasis on teaching about money and the content of that teaching that it's one of the most telling factors about your faith and your priorities. And if so, it will be one of the most important lessons that you can teach your children. If you want them to be good stewards of their finances one day, it will be important for you to teach them about stewardship of the finances of the family today. A few years ago, one of my daughters comes up to me and asks, "Papa, are we poor?" And that was when I realized we need to talk more openly with our kids about finances and biblical stewardship. So my wife Pearl and I decided to gather the family every Thanksgiving to talk about our family finances and to budget together our church and missions giving and to decide together as a family how to invest those God-given resources. We tell the kids, this is how much money God has provided for our family every month. And this is how much we spend on X, Y, and Z, and this is how much we would like to set aside for giving to the church and for global missions. It's not a huge amount, but it's a percentage along the lines that I encourage you all to consider. But it will eventually allow our family the privilege and joy to be able to invest for God's global glory, the equivalent of more than $1 million. If God could do that through a missionary family of seven, what could he do through your family? For the Great Commission, for the accomplishing of the Lord's purpose in life, great sacrifices are needed. Sacrifice by those who will go, laying aside comfort and family and the American dream, and sacrifice for those who will send. At the third Lausanne Congress in South Africa, an 18-year-old high school girl from North Korea shared her story. This young girl was born into a wealthy family, relatively wealthy family in North Korea. Her father was an assistant to the North Korean leader, Kim Jong-il. Eventually, her father's political fortunes shifted, and after being politically persecuted by the North Korean government, he, his wife, and his daughter escaped to China. In China, a relative brought her family to church, where her parents came to know Jesus Christ. A few months later, however, her pregnant mother died from leukemia. Her father started to study the Bible with missionaries, and eventually the Lord gave him a strong desire to become a missionary to North Korea. But in 2001, he was reported as a Christian, was arrested by the Chinese police, and was returned to North Korea. Forced to leave his daughter behind in China, he spent 3 years in prison. Eventually, he was able to return to China, where he was briefly reunited with his daughter. Soon after, however, he gathered Bibles, having resolved to return to North Korea to share Christ among that hopeless people. In 2006, he was discovered by the North Korean government and was arrested. There has since been no word from him. In all probability, he has been shot to death publicly for treason. There are those around the world who have risked or given their very lives for the purpose of God, the hallowing of God's name. Some of you today may be feeling in the depth of your soul and distinct, undeniable calling and passion to go into the world as a missionary. that the cry of your heart, that the conviction of your life is to invest your everything for God's global glory. That your heart both prays, Lord, hallowed be your name among the unreached peoples of the world, and your heart conviction compels you to go and invest your life to see that hallowing happen. If so, I invite you to talk with your family and friends and the leadership of your church, ask for their prayers and counsel, and pursue God's calling with prayer and passion. You will not regret it. And if you go, I urge you to consider the unreached, to consider the hardest of mission fields, like reaching Muslims or the Japanese, and to go while you are young. Expect things to be hard. Expect opposition, but persevere. By the grace of God, persevere. How many could be won to Christ, both near and far, if we could just persevere? We have friends ministering among the precious Uyghur people in China, and they talk about how, apparently on average, it takes about 40 exposures to the gospel before a Uyghur will believe. 40. As you share the gospel with those who are near and far, with family members and strangers, persevere. How many could be won to Christ if we would persevere through 40 gospel sharings? In 2007, the North Korean girl, who at the time was not a Christian, was given the opportunity to go to South Korea. While still in China, waiting at the Korean consulate in Beijing to go to South Korea, she saw Jesus in a dream. Jesus, with tears in his eyes, called her by name and said, "How much longer are you going to keep me waiting? Walk with me. Yes, you lost your earthly father, but I am your heavenly father, and whatever has happened to you is because I love you." She knelt and prayed to God for the first time and realized that God, my Father, loves and cares for me so very much that he sent his son Jesus to die for me. And she prayed, "God, here I am. I just lay down everything and give you my heart, my soul, my mind, and my strength. Please use me as you will." And now God has given her a great love for North Korea. She shares, "Just as my father was used there for God's kingdom, I now desire to be obedient to God. I want to bring the love of Jesus to North Korea." What a fool. If you escape hell on earth, you don't return. What a fool for Christ. But this is the path and global flow of the gospel from everywhere to everywhere, even North Korea, even hell on earth. How many of us so easily choose the path of comfort and safety, the path that is our answer to the question, what is best for me? We seek the provisions of God, but neglect his purposes. And in holding on to those provisions, we halt the advance of his kingdom that Jesus teaches us to pray for and to pursue. So many of those whom God has used to make some of the greatest kingdom impact have been those who have not made decisions based on, what's best for me? My will be done. They made decisions based on an undeniable, unshakable, illogical, foolish passion for Jesus Christ and for the building of his global kingdom. You know, for this girl's father, there was a safe path before him. The door was open for him to go to South Korea, where there was political freedom and religious freedom, where he and his family could have been safe, where there was daily bread and so much more. He could have come to the U.S. and pursued the American dream and enjoyed worshiping God at a great church and enjoyed freedom and Friday night Bible study. No prison, no persecution, no pain. Instead, he chose the path of danger that led him, Bibles in hand, back to North Korea, the homeland that he loved. And now his daughter has determined to follow that same path. Both father and daughter passionately praying for and pursuing the worship of God among the North Koreans. That the global gospel flow might not end simply with them lifting their hands in a comfortable pew, in a comfortable place, enjoying the gospel while North Koreans go to hell without Jesus Christ. Hallowed be thy name, O Lord, in North Korea. Hallowed be thy name, O Lord, in all the earth. May God grant us the grace to serve with undeniable, unshakable, illogical, and foolish passion for the hallowing of God's name and the building of his global kingdom. Let's pray. Please stand with me as we close in prayer. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. And toward that end, O God, give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our debts, as we also have forgiven our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever.